touch.
The trial court for the county of Iron is now in session. The Honorable Richard J. Salello presiding.
Please be seated.
Attorneys are present, the jury is all present and accounted for in the jury box. Members of the jury, good morning. I apologize for the delay here. We're taking care of some housekeeping matters. Ms. Paul, are you ready to proceed?
We are, Your Honor. People call Todd Wilton.
Mr. Wilton, please step forward. If you would stand, sir, raise your right hand and be sworn.
Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you shall give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth under the penalty of perjury?
Yes, I do.
Please have a seat up here at the witness stand.
Please state your name.
Yeah, Todd Wilton, T-O-D-D-W-I-L-T-O-N.
And what is your occupation?
Special agent with Homeland Security Investigations.
And what do your duties consist of?
With Homeland Security Investigations, or HSI, we have the most federal jurisdiction over the most statutes over any other federal law enforcement agency. Of those statutes or programmatic areas, I'm primarily assigned online child sexual exploitation cases. And then I'm also a member of two Internet Crimes Against Children, or ICAC, task forces in Marquette and Traverse City, and work group cases as well as with them.
And we had Detective Sergeant Wes Smith testify in this courtroom earlier. Do you know Detective Sergeant Wes Smith?
Yes, he's the commander of one of the ICAC task forces.
And that's one that you sit on?
Correct.
Were you employed somewhere else prior to being with the Department of Homeland Security?
Yes.
Okay, where were you previously employed?
I was an officer with U.S. Customs and Border Protection in Port Huron, Michigan for 5 years.
And what office do you presently work out of at this time?
Sault Ste. Marie.
Were you asked to do something with respect to a missing person investigation in February of 2015?
Yes, I was.
Who asked you to do something?
Detective Sergeant Wesley Smith.
And what were you asked to do?
He asked if I could query our databases for any records that would indicate the whereabouts of a missing person.
And what information, if any, were you given about the missing person before you took action?
He gave me the full name and date of birth.
Is it necessary to know some of the circumstances in order to provide assistance?
Yes.
And did you have anything else other than the name and date of birth?
Other than it was a missing person, that's all I knew.
And who was the person that you checked on?
His last name's Reagan. And his middle name's Carl, last name's Reagan. I can't remember his first name.
I think the jury probably knows, but was it Christopher?
Christopher Carl Reagan.
So what did you do in order to check on Christopher Carl Reagan?
I queried all of our databases. I looked for any flight manifests that he would have been departing or entering the country. I checked for a valid passport, which he currently today still has a valid passport. I asked the Social Security Administration if they would run queries to see if they had any records of him. That came back with negative results, and then I also checked for border crossings.
Okay, so you said that there was no Social Security number activity, is that correct?
Correct.
Was there a date that was associated with, or a time frame that was associated with?
No, I just asked them, could you run anything currently, and they came back and said no, there was nothing.
Okay, and this was in February, correct?
Correct.
Of 2015?
Correct.
All right, what about his passport? Was there any results on the passport?
He has a valid passport that was issued in, I believe it was June. I think it was May of 2011, and it's good for till May of 2021.
And did you also check flight manifests?
I did.
And what were the results of flight manifests?
All that was there is he flew in June of 2011 to Cancun, Mexico from Detroit, and returned 7 days later.
Were you asked to run similar checks again?
Yes, I was.
And when was that?
September of 2015.
And what, if anything, did you find out?
There was no additional information.
So no activity concerning Mr. Reagan?
No.
Thank you, no further questions.
Thank you. Cross-examination, Mr. Schroeder.
Morning, sir, how are you?
Good morning, how are you, Chef?
Hear me okay?
I'm sorry? Yes.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can.
Thank you. Now, you indicated that you checked the flight manifest, correct?
Correct.
Again, all that would tell you is whether or not he was on a plane to fly somewhere, correct?
In or out of the country, yes.
Okay, so domestically, no. So if you went from Detroit to Chicago, it wouldn't tell you. If you went from Detroit to London, let's say.
That I would. Internationally, yes. Domestic, no.
So the only thing you would know from checking the flight manifest was he didn't get on a flight to Cancun or London or Rome or something.
Correct.
And same for the border crossing records that you checked. Yeah, just the only thing that would tell you is he didn't cross the bridge there between Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, Sault Ste. Marie, Canada, correct? Or any other border crossing?
Mexico or Canada, correct.
Sure. So again, it doesn't tell you specifically where he was or what he was doing, just tells you that he didn't do those certain things, such as get on a plane, fly overseas, or cross a border by a car or flights, correct?
Correct.
Thank you. Nothing else?
Thank you, sir. You can...
Maybe he can excuse from his... No, and I don't expect that I will need him for rebuttal, so maybe...
Okay, you're excused from your subpoena, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
People call Lisa Orovitz. Mr. Yeager, could you...
Stand, raise your right hand, Ms. Warren.
Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you shall give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth under the penalty of perjury?
Yes, I do.
Please be seated.
Please state your name and spell your last name.
Lisa Orovitz, O-R-A-V-E-T-Z.
And what is your current occupation?
I'm a forensic scientist.
And do you work for a laboratory?
I do. I work for the Michigan State Police Marquette Forensic Laboratory.
And how long have you been employed with the Michigan State Police?
I've been there about 3.5 years.
And how long have you been assigned to the Marquette Laboratory?
About 3.5 years.
And prior to the Michigan State Police, where were you employed?
I was a contractor at the Dow Chemical Company through Kelly Services.
And what type of duties did you have there?
I was an analytical technician, so I prepared and analyzed research samples, and I wrote reports regarding my findings.
And is that the Dow Chemical that's out of Midland, or is that one of the other areas?
Midland, Michigan.
How long were you a contractor there?
About a year.
And what is your educational background?
I have a Bachelor of Science degree in Biochemistry from Saginaw Valley State University.
And when did you graduate from the university?
2012.
Is the proper term for what you do a forensic scientist?
Yes.
And do you specialize in any particular areas of forensic science?
I specialize in biology.
And is there a particular area of biology that you deal with, a subspecialty?
I deal with body fluid identification, swabbing items for contact DNA, and hair evaluations.
And as part of your duties at the Marquette Crime Lab, do you have to go out to crime scenes?
I do, yes.
When you started as a forensic scientist with the Michigan State Police, was there a mandatory training protocol that you had to participate in?
Yes, there was. The mandatory training protocol consisted of a series of modules, and each module was dedicated to a different aspect of biology analysis. Under the supervision and direction of a senior analyst, I observed casework, tested numerous practice samples, explore the testing procedures and methods used in biology, and learn about their strengths and weaknesses. When that was completed, I completed a series of competency tests.
And how long did that take?
It took me about 8 months to complete.
Did you have any additional trainings that were not part of the mandatory training protocol?
I did. I've had the opportunity to take trainings in blood stain pattern analysis, hair evaluations, crime scene processing, and evidence collection.
And do you belong to any professional associations?
I am an associate member of the Midwestern Association of Forensic Scientists.
And how long have you been doing analysis on your own cases?
Since March of 2014.
Are there any other biologists at the Marquette Laboratory?
Yes, there is. I work with one other biologist. Her name is forensic scientist Shannon Aho.
Approximately how many times have you offered reports stating your conclusions regarding biology, trace evidence, body fluids?
Over 600 reports have been issued since my employment.
And have you testified as an expert witness previously regarding your findings?
Yes, I have.
And approximately how many times?
I've testified 6 times, and I've been offered as an, I've qualified as an expert every time it has been offered, which has been 4 times.
And has that been in circuit court as well as district court?
The offerings were given, or the qualifications were given in district court. I'm sorry, in circuit court, but I have testified in district court as well.
And did you testify as recently as yesterday?
I did.
And was that in Menominee County?
Yes, it was.
Were you qualified at that time?
Yes, I was.
Your Honor, we would move at this time to qualify her as an expert witness in the area of biology, body fluids, trace evidence.
Thank you. I'm going to allow Ms. Horvitz to testify by way of opinion, evidence, and her field of expertise.
So we talked about your specialty being body fluid in the biology unit. Is there another department or part of the biology unit within the Michigan State Police?
Yes, there is. The biology unit is divided into 2 groups. There is body fluid identification, which is what I am a part of, and then there is DNA analysis.
And do you analyze for both groups?
No, just the body fluid identification group.
And do you have some responsibilities with respect to preparing items for DNA analysis?
Yes, I do. Evidence comes into the laboratory, it is analyzed, and then I prepare the samples for DNA and then send them down to the Grand Rapids Laboratory, and that's where our DNA analysis is performed.
When you receive evidence in the lab setting, what do you generally do first?
Usually I perform a visual exam to look for any sort of staining. I have a bright light that allows me to view the evidence under better light. And I search for potential body fluids. In this case, I was looking for blood. From then on, I go ahead and perform a presumptive test called tetramethylbenzidine, which is a presumptive test for blood. I perform a screening test to see if it is blood or not.
You said the presumptive test. I didn't catch the name.
Tetramethylbenzidine. The abbreviation is TMB.
And what does the presumptive test do? How do you actually apply it?
It is a chemical test. A presumptive test means it is simply a screening tool because there are other substances that can react with it. So it is a screening tool used to say this could be blood or it's not blood.
And yesterday we had some testimony from the FBI evidence response team leader. Is Blue Star a presumptive test as well?
Yes, Blue Star is a presumptive test. It's similar to Luno.
And similar to Bloodhound? Is that a presumptive?
I'm not familiar with that?
Okay.
I'm not familiar with that one.
So you guys use TMB. Does that sometimes have interference or false reactions?
Yes, it does. It can also give false positive reactions with dirt, some metals, rust, and some cleaners.
So dirt, metals, rust, cleaning agents. Does mold affect it at all?
Yes, it can.
And when you indicate it's a presumptive test and you're testing to see if there's a presence of blood, are we talking human blood or animal blood, or does it not differentiate?
Tetramethylbenzidine does not differentiate between human blood or animal blood.
And do you sometimes use more than one test at a time?
Yes, I do.
Why?
Depending on if I'm obtaining a false positive or some interference reaction, there is another presumptive test I can use called Hemostix, which is a test similar to tetramethylbenzidine. It is a test strip, and there's a little pad on the end where you place your sample and you look for a color change reaction.
And is there something called Hematrace?
Yes, there is. Hematrace is a more specific test that I will use and that can detect human blood.
Is that used in the laboratory or is that used on scene?
It's usually used in the laboratory.
Have there been times when you've used it on scene?
Yes, there have been occasions, but it's pretty rare to bring it out to the scene.
And what is Luminol?
Luminol is another presumptive blood test that is usually used when there is very little visible blood staining or if there is no visible blood staining.
Does that have the same issues with interference or false positives?
Yes, there are several false positives with Luvenol. It can react with cleaning agents, such as bleach. It can react with plant material, smoke, and metals.
And I believe we talked briefly regarding ALS, that's alternative light source?
Yes, that's correct.
Is that something that you use during your visual examination?
Sometimes I'll use that for my visual examination, yes. Some body fluids will fluoresce under different wavelengths of light, and I use that piece of equipment to use different wavelengths to see if I can see body fluids. Blood absorbs under different wavelengths of light. So in this case, I was looking for absorption instead of fluorescence.
When or how do you decide to swab a piece of evidence for DNA?
It really depends on the piece of evidence and the case circumstances. Evidence will be swabbed for contact DNA if we are trying to find someone's DNA that should not be on it. If a piece of evidence is taken from someone's vehicle or their residence, and you would expect their DNA to be on it. So at that point, it would not be swabbed. But if you're looking for someone's DNA that should not be there, that's when that piece of evidence will be swabbed for DNA.
When you receive a piece of evidence in the laboratory, and let's say your presumptive test is positive, what would you do next with it in the laboratory?
I would perform additional testing, more specific testing. So in this case, if it was tetramethylbenzidine positive, I would go ahead and perform the hematrace test to see if it is human blood or not.
And if you have a positive and it's human blood, what would be the next step in the process?
A sample would be taken and sent for DNA.
Now, when we're talking body fluids, in this case, you're specifically looking for blood. Is there another body fluid that you have had occasion to look for in other cases?
I have training to look for saliva and semen as well.
If you're on a crime scene, and are you part of the crime scene team?
Yes, I am.
Okay. What would you do first on a crime scene?
Usually we have a conversation with the investigating agency to get some case information and some facts as to what they're looking for and what the situation is. From there, general notes of the exterior of the scene, if it's a residence or something like that, the exterior notes are taken in addition to photos. Then photos and notes are taken on the interior before any processing is actually done.
And who else is on the team with you, or what personnel from the laboratory?
There are several members on the crime scene team at the laboratory. Forensic scientist Zach Blacksmith, forensic scientist Shannon Aho, Detective Lieutenant Kathy Boyer. During this case, Detective Sergeant Jay Peterson was on the team, but he has now left the laboratory. And then we have three trainees currently.
And Zach Blacksmith, what are his specialties?
He works in the Controlled Substances Unit.
And Jay Peterson, we had testified, so we know he was the latent print analyst. Shannon Aho, we said, is in biology. Was it Lieutenant Boyer or Detective Sergeant Boyer?
Detective Lieutenant Kathy Boyer.
Detective.
She works in the latent print unit.
So has she taken Peterson's spot?
Yes, she has.
So how do you decide what to look for when you're at a crime scene?
Again, it's a case-by-case basis. There's a lot of discussion with the investigating agency. It depends on the circumstances of the case. Some processes may not be necessary. It depends on the relationship between the victim and suspect, what interactions they've had with the scene, should their DNA or fingerprints be there, or are they expected to be there, that kind of thing. There's a lot of communication that goes on between members of the team and the investigating agency about the case and what would be helpful versus not so helpful.
If the scene is, for example, an outdoor crime scene, would that affect what evidence you take?
Yes, it would.
With respect to, and you briefly talked about or touched on, the relationship between the victim and the suspect. If, for example, a victim has been known to be in and out of a suspect's residence on a daily basis, would you necessarily take latent prints?
No, because we would expect to find latent prints there. And there's no way to tell when they were deposited. They were deposited during the commission of a crime, or if they were deposited just from the person being there.
And would the same hold true for DNA evidence?
Yes, that is correct.
What about trace evidence? Is that also correct?
Yes, that's correct as well.
Let's go over what work you performed in this case, and could you tell the jury, when evidence comes into the laboratory, how the laboratory keeps track of that evidence?
The evidence, when it comes into the laboratory, is logged into our computer system, and at that point, the chain of custody starts within the laboratory. Once it is logged in, it is placed in a secure storage facility until it is ready to be examined.
So, the first item that you guys examined in this case, was that a motor vehicle?
Yes, it was.
And what type of motor vehicle was it?
It was a Hyundai Genesis car.
And where was it examined at?
It was examined in our vehicle processing bay in our garage.
And do you recall the date that it was examined?
It was examined on November 3rd, 2014.
And what did you do first with respect to the vehicle?
General notes and general photos were taken of the interior and the exterior of the vehicle. When that was complete, inventory was taken of what was inside the vehicle. And then I went ahead and did biology processing. I viewed the interior with a bright light to see if I could find any sort of suspected blood staining. And if I found a stain, I would do the tetramethylbenzidine chemical test on it.
And with respect to this particular vehicle, when you say general notes, would you note the VIN number, the serial number, the plate number?
That is correct, yes.
And what was the overall condition of this particular vehicle?
The vehicle was very clean and free of clutter. There were some items in there, but it was overall a fairly clean vehicle.
And did you have keys for this particular vehicle?
No, we did not.
How did you gain access?
We were informed that the vehicle was opened by the investigating agency, and it arrived to us open.
And do you recall if there were any items inside the vehicle when you received it?
Yes, there were.
And I'm not going to ask you to list all of the items, but could you give the jury some examples of some items that were found inside the vehicle?
There were some items of clothing in the front seat. There was a pair of gloves in the back seat. There was some change in the door. There were some drinking containers, and then there were some items in the trunk. I believe an umbrella was in there, and a few other items.
Did latent print unit do anything with respect to this vehicle?
Yes, they examined the vehicle as well.
And as for biology, what, if anything, did you do with respect to the vehicle?
I performed my bright light exam and any chemical testing on stains that I located, and all testing was negative.
Was this vehicle returned to the agency, or was it turned over to another unit?
It was turned over to another unit.
In which unit was it turned over to?
I believe it was turned over to the computer crimes unit.
And what was the reason for that, if you know?
I don't recall at this time.
Okay. Was there a GPS unit in the vehicle?
As far as I know, there was, yes.
I'm going to have you turn now to record number 3. And what did you do with respect to record number 3, or what scene were you examining?
This was an examination of Mr. Reagan's apartment.
And how did it end up that you went to Mr. Reagan's apartment?
We received a call from the chief of police from Iron River asking us to process the scene for latent blood using the mouth.
And what information did you have, if any, with respect to the case before you went to the scene?
We knew that Mr. Reagan was missing and had not been back to his apartment, and that he was scheduled to attend a drug test and did not make it.
So when you went to the scene, was this a missing persons case?
Yes, it was.
Does that present any particular difficulty with respect to processing the crime scene?
It does, yes.
And why is that?
We don't know what happened, we don't really know what to look for.
So, what day did you end up going to the apartment?
May I refer to the
report? And record number 3 is in evidence?
No. But thank you for that reminder.
We went to Mr. Reagan's apartment on November 24th, 2014.
Your Honor, I know that these are, I believe this would be a joint exhibit. I don't believe that Mr. Schulke would have any any problem with that? Would it be all right if we admitted that at a later date and allowed her testimony?
I have a problem there.
Thank you.
That's been marked as what? Has it been marked?
It has not been marked, Your Honor.
Okay.
If we could just allow her testimony from the report, and we will admit the reports that much time.
All right.
I'm familiar with the reports, Your Honor. That's fine.
Thank you.
So, I'm sorry, what date did you go?
November 24th, 2014.
And upon arrival, what did you observe?
The apartment was sealed and secured. We were escorted in by Chief Nora Frizzo. And we took general notes, general photos, and the apartment was in a state of moving. There were several boxes and totes, partially packed boxes, scattered throughout the apartment.
And were there photographs taken of the exterior and the interior at that time?
Yes.
Okay. I would like to review some of those photographs with you. And this has, Your Honor, at this time, we would move to admit joint exhibits 36 apartment, and item 37 are printed copies of the photographs, not in their entirety, but printed copies of the photographs contained on the scene.
So joint exhibit?
Yes, sir.
Received 36 and 37.
Okay. And these are numbered, Your Honor, so right now we're looking at slide number 1 of exhibit 37. Ms. Orwitz, could you tell us what we are viewing in this slide?
This is the exterior door to a series of apartments that was upstairs. So you enter the door and there was a stairway to go upstairs, and there were 4 apartments upstairs.
And slide number 2 of 37, is this the stairway going upstairs to the apartments?
Yes, it is.
Slide number 3, the upper portion of the stairway?
Yes, that's correct.
Is there only one hallway going down to the apartment?
Yes.
Slide number 4, is this the hallway where the apartment was located?
Yes, it is.
I see in this photograph that there are some rugs outside of the doors. Did he have a particular rug outside of his door?
Yes, he did. He had the red rug.
So his apartment would be the first door on the left in this slide?
Yes, that is correct.
Slide number 5 of 37, what are we looking at in this picture?
This photo was taken right outside the front door. So the front door was open, a photo was taken, and this is the hallway into the apartment.
So in slide number 5, is there a closet on the left-hand side?
Yes, there is.
And what would be the next door on the left-hand side, or doorway? And after the doorway to the bedroom, there appears to be something sticking out of the wall. Could you tell us what that is? If I may approach what is here, I'm not sure if this is the photograph.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Archway, if I recall correctly, I believe it was a shelf, but I don't remember exactly.
Do you recall if there were items on that shelf?
I don't recall.
Okay. Slide number 6, what are we looking at in this picture?
The first doorway, the first entryway on the right, down that hallway, this is a photo of that. There is an open closet on the left-hand side, and then straight through is the bathroom.
So the closet is actually between the hallway and the bathroom?
Yes.
Slide number 7, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is Mr. Reagan's bedroom.
And it appears there are some packing items on that, is that accurate?
Yes.
Looks like I put this in there twice. Slide number 9, what are we looking at in this photograph?
This is Mr. Reagan's kitchen.
And what items, if any, are in the sink in this photograph?
There were several dirty dishes in the sink.
And is that a big box in front of the stove?
Yes, it is.
Were there other items of interest in the kitchen that you Known off the top of your head?
Not off the top of my head.
Slide number 10. Okay, slide number 11. What do we see in this view?
This is the dining room. So you're viewing the dining room table.
And it appears there is a bunch of paperwork on the dining room table. Did you guys review that paperwork?
We did, yes.
This is slide number 12. What are we looking at in this picture?
This is Mr. Reagan's bedroom.
And this is just a view further to the right than the previous slide?
Yes, that is correct.
Slide number 13, what are we looking at in this photograph?
This is another image from Mr. Reagan's bedroom, but it's to the left more, and you can see his closet that's inside the bedroom.
It appears from the closet door that there's something hanging on the closet door. Do you recall what that was?
I don't recall what it was.
Does it appear to be a t-shirt or a towel?
Yes, it appears to be so.
And does it have writing on it?
Yes, it does.
And what does it say?
I cannot read that.
If I approach with this slide, would you read it? May I approach the witness room?
Yes.
Okay, this is slide number 13 of exhibit 37.
It says Old Navy.
This is slide number 14. What are we looking at in this picture?
This is the exterior of the building. If you go all the way down the hallway, there was a set of stairs. If you go down the stairs, it leads you out into this alleyway.
And is this, what side of the building is this alleyway on?
I believe it's the back side, but I'm not certain.
Do you know if it's the north side, east side, west side?
May I refer to my notes? Appears to be the north side of the building.
And do you know what building is adjacent to or connected to this apartment building?
If I recall correctly, it was some sort of business.
I'm showing you slide number 15 now. There's a doorway in this picture. Where does this doorway lead, if you know?
If I recall correctly, that is the doorway that goes up the stairs and to the hallway.
So are there two entrances to the hallway upstairs?
Yes, there are.
And the one that we saw on the very first slide, was that on the south side of the building?
It would have been on the south side, yes.
I'm showing you slide number 16. Is this just a continuation of that alleyway that we saw on the previous slide?
Yes, it is.
Now, when you arrived at the scene, you took the photographs, you took your notes. What was the first thing that you did with respect to analysis once you arrived there?
I took general notes once those and the general photos were done. I viewed the bathroom and the kitchen sink with a light to see if there was any staining in there, and then the bathroom sink, the kitchen sink, and the bathtub were sprayed with luminol.
Was there any reaction?
No, there was not.
Did you spray any other areas of the apartment with luminol?
No, I did not.
Did you note or make notes of what type of paperwork was around the home?
There were several to-do lists and reminders. There was some information about a drug test. Inside some of the packaging boxes, there were notes about addresses and where to send things to, but there were several to-do lists.
Did you, you said that you were accompanied by Chief Frizzo. Were items seized from the residents by you at all, or were they, or was the search warrant executed during that time when items seized?
We did not, the crime scene team did not seize any items. Any items that were collected would have been collected by Chief Bizzle.
I want to direct your attention now to record number 8. Were you presented with some items to analyze in record number 8?
Yes, I was.
And what were you presented with?
I received a bike helmet, a hat, and a used floss pick that were identified as coming from Mr. Reagan's apartment. They were submitted as a presumed known DNA sample. Then I also received contact swabs from his vehicle, from the steering wheel.
And did you do anything with the bicycle helmet?
Nothing was done with the bicycle helmet.
Why is that?
I used the floss pick as a reference DNA sample, mainly because, and for the same with the hat, some people share helmets or share hats. So there could be a possibility that it could be somebody else's DNA in there.
And may I approach the witness, Your Honor?
Yes.
I'm showing you what's been marked as joint exhibit number 42. Do you recognize that item?
Yes, I do.
Okay, do you recognize it by the submission number?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And are your initials on that item?
Yes, it is.
What is that item, to your knowledge?
This is the sample that I took from the floss pick as Mr. Reagan's presumed known DNA sample.
And is this floss pick included, or is it just the swab inside?
It is actually just the swab inside.
And what did you do with, or how did you process the floss pick?
I took one wet swab and one dry swab and swabbed the floss pick. They were allowed to dry, and then they were cut and put into a small plastic tube. A small plastic tube was then put into a small manila envelope, and that envelope was put in this one.
And did you forward that on to another location?
I forwarded it to the Grand Rapids Laboratory.
I'm also showing you what's been marked as People's Joint Exhibit number 43. Do you recognize that item?
Yes, I do.
And what is that?
This is the container that holds the sample from the steering wheel that was set for DNA.
And did you also prepare that in the same fashion that you did with respect to the floss pick?
These swabs were cut and put in an extraction tube, and then, yes, put in a small manila envelope, and that envelope was put in here.
And what did you do with the sample that you prepared? Did you forward it on to the Grand Rapids Laboratory?
Yes, it was forwarded on to the Grand Rapids.
Did you do anything else with respect to these two items?
No, I did not.
I want to now direct your attention to record number 12. What is this record reference?
This is in reference to a residence at 66 Lawrence Street in Aspen. Okay.
And did you execute or process a crime scene at that residence?
Yes, I did.
And just for the jury's information, when you process a crime scene, do you generally have a search warrant available to you that allows you access to the scene?
Yes.
And did you have that in this particular case?
Yes.
What date did you process this particular scene?
The scene was processed on March 5th, 2015.
And what information did you have about the scene prior to going there?
We were informed that there was new information in the missing persons case involving Mr. Reagan, and that he may have been in the Cochrane home.
And what time of day did you arrive?
May I report on that? We arrived at approximately 3 p.m.
Your Honor, I'm moving at this time for admission of People's Joint Exhibit number 38, which are photographs from the scene processed by Michigan State Police on 3/5/2015 at the Cochran household, and for joint exhibit number 39, which are printed photographs of the same.
Thank you. Hearing and considering it's a joint exhibit, receiving them both.
So you had a pre-scene briefing. When you arrived at the scene, I believe you described your process as first taking notes and photographs of the exterior and the interior of the residence. Is that accurate?
Yes.
I'd like to go over some of those photographs with you at this time. To your knowledge, had was this the first search warrant that was executed at the Cochran household?
To my knowledge, yes.
As far as the crime scene?
As far as the crime scene, yes.
What are we looking at in this view?
This is the exterior of the home.
And this is slide one of 39. I'm going to go through these fairly quickly because the jury has seen some of these, but there are some items of interest that they would, that they want to see. Slide two, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is, again, the exterior of the residence, but slightly to the left.
And we see a garage in this picture. Could you tell us what direction we're looking in relation to the house?
The garage, I believe, is to the north.
Okay.
Can I confirm my notes?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Yes, the garage is to the north.
Slide number three, is this the house that is to the north of the Cochran house?
Yes, yes.
Slide number four, is this the a view of the street looking north from the Cochran household?
Yes, it is.
And it appears in that photograph that the street curves left?
Yes, it does.
Or west, I guess I should say. Slide number five, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is another view of the exterior of the residence.
Slide number six, when you arrived, was there anything outside of the house?
There were trash cans and trash bags outside.
Slide number seven, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is a close-up view of the front of the house. You can see the front door, and there's a wooden ramp that comes off the front door.
Were there any items to your recollection underneath the ramp?
I don't recall.
And here's slide number eight. That's a better view of the ramp?
Yes, there was a plastic tub.
So the plastic tub underneath. Slide number nine, again, is that another view of the ramp?
Yes, it is.
What are we looking at in slide number 10?
This is a view of the back of the residence. There is a garage and a vehicle to the east.
Is there an alleyway behind the residence?
Yes.
And in the foreground of this picture, do there appear to be some items just sitting out in the snow?
Yes.
What are those items?
I believe they are buckets.
In slide number 12, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is another view of the back of the residence.
And we see some buckets, those same buckets that were in the last slide on the left of that picture?
Yes.
Do you know what that item is that looks like a black stick sticking up out of the snow? Do you recall what that was?
I don't recall what that was.
And do you know what the items under the tarp are?
No, I don't.
Slide number 13, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is a closer picture of the garage that is to the east of the residence.
And slide number nine, it's 15. What is this picture?
I believe that is a picture of a sticker or a decal on the truck.
And did you guys actually process the vehicle or merely take notes and photographs?
We took notes and photographs and we did some luminol testing inside the vehicle.
And slide number 16. What are we looking at in this picture?
This is another view of the garage. You can see the residence just to the left.
And are there some items in the foreground?
Yes.
What are those items?
They appear to be tools.
Slide number 17. What are we looking at this picture?
This is another image of the garage, just a little to the left, and you can see the alley behind it.
And is this view looking north?
Yes, it is.
And does it appear that the alleyway ends at the blue garage in the picture?
It appears to, yes.
And in slide number 18, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is the alleyway that appears to be to the south.
And does it appear in this picture to curve around to the right?
Yes, it does.
Or to the west? Slide number 19. What is in this picture and where was this picture taken?
This picture was taken just inside the front door. This is the foyer mudroom, and this is just to the right of the door.
Slide number 20. What is in this picture?
This is the floor just inside the front door.
And this appears to be, is this plywood or is this hardwood flooring?
Appears to be plywood.
Picture number, or slide number 21. What are we looking at in this picture?
This is another picture taken from inside the front door. The front door led into the mudroom, which then led into the dining room. So you can see those entryways.
And I see blue walls in the, probably the middle ground of this picture. Is that the dining room?
Yes.
And I see a doorway just to the left of that blue wall. Where does that doorway lead?
That led into the kitchen.
Slide number 22, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is a view of the front door from inside the dining room.
And when you do these pictures, do you open up items? For example, it looks like there's something out, like a closet of some sort on the right-hand side?
Yes, usually we'll open up closets and photograph what's inside.
Slide number 23. Is this another view or a different view of the items in the foyer?
Yes, it is.
And a closer view, slide number 24?
Yes.
And when you do take evidence pictures, is there a process when you take evidence pictures?
For evidence, usually you take a perspective shot, so you know where the item of evidence was located. Then you take a mid-range and then a close-up photo.
And the close-up photo is more detailed?
Yes.
And I see some tools in this picture. This is, again, slide number 24. Is there a shovel in that picture? Might be too far away for you to see.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Slide number 25. Could you tell us what we're looking at in this picture?
That appears to be the closet that is in the foyer.
Slide number 26. Are those also items in the upper portion of the closet?
Yes, that's correct.
Slide number 27, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is the door that leads from the foyer or the mudroom into the dining room.
And in the foreground of that picture, what is attached to the door or on the door?
Duct tape.
And did you have an opportunity to examine what was underneath the duct tape?
Yes.
And what was underneath the duct tape?
A hole.
Was there anything of interest to you about the duct tape or the hole?
It just seemed odd and out of place. The duct tape looked new, but I can't say how long it had been there.
Slide number 28. What are we looking at in this picture and what room are we in?
This photo was taken in the dining room. This is the west wall of the dining room. So the entryway to the foyer is just to the right in this picture.
And what is the item leaning up against the doorway in that particular picture? Do you need a closer view?
Yes, can I get a closer view?
May I approach your eye?
Yes.
Showing you slide number 28.
It appears to be a black case.
Oh, in your experience, would it appear to be a gun case?
Yes, it could be a gun case.
Also in slide number 28, is that a some sort of shelving unit to the left of the black case?
Yes.
And between the shelving unit and the black case, is there an item leading up against the shelving unit?
Yes, there's a baseball bat.
And on the shelving unit itself, is there an item that is rolled up? Or a roll of something?
Yes.
And what is that item?
I don't recall what that item was.
If I approached with a closer view, would that assist you?
To be plastic of some sort, but I'm not certain.
Okay, slide number 29. Are we still in the dining room area?
Yes, we are.
And what do we see in this picture?
This is another shelving unit that supports a couple paint cans. It appears that they were doing some remodeling or redecorating or painting of some sort.
Slide number 30. What is in this particular picture?
This is a picture taken just above the shelving unit, and it shows the walls and the ceiling.
Was there anything of interest in this corner or this area of the ceiling?
Not that I recall, no.
Slide number 31, is this a picture of electrical cords?
Yes, it is.
Slide number 32, is this the same shelving unit?
Yes, it is.
Is this a closer picture?
Yes, it is.
Slide number 33, a closer picture of the items on the shelving unit where you saw the plastic?
Yes.
Slide number 34, what are we looking at in this picture?
This photo was in the dining room and you are looking into the living room.
And it's rather dark in this picture, is that correct?
Yes.
When you do go into a home and you take evidence-seeking photos, do you bring your own lighting?
Yes, we do.
And was that lighting used in this picture?
The flash on the camera was, but I believe the light that was used is to the left in this picture.
Item number 35, slide number 35, what do we see in this picture?
This is another view into the living room.
And I'm looking at the carpeting. Was there anything of interest in the carpeting?
There is an area of discoloration in the carpet.
Item number 36, looks like the picture needs to be rotated, but what are we seeing in that picture?
It appears to be a couple of cell phones.
And in slide number 37, what are we seeing in that picture?
It appears to be some keys and then a gun and a holster.
Slide number 38, what are we seeing in that picture and what room are we in?
This picture was taken in the dining room. This is the table that was in the dining room. It appears that there is some sort of tobacco on the table. You can also see the gun was there, and it appears that there's a walker or a cane on one of the chairs.
Slide number 39. What are we looking at in this picture?
That's another photo of the door.
And that is a closer photograph of the door with the duct tape?
Yes.
And was this door between the foyer and the dining room?
Yes.
Slide number 40, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is the backside of the door between the foyer and the dining room, and it appears that there's a bulletin board over it.
I'm sorry, it appears there's what?
A bulletin board, or some sort of cork board.
And slide number 41, is that a closer picture of the cork board?
Yes, it is.
And do you see any damage in the cork board in this picture?
Yes.
And what do you see?
There appears to be a crack. There appears to be like a crack in the floor.
Slide number 42, the lighting is a little bad on this slide, but what room are we looking into?
This one, you're looking into the kitchen.
And is there an animal in the picture?
There is a dog in a crate, yes.
Item number 43, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is another view of the kitchen. It is a cabinet with several bottles of what appears to be medicine.
And did you guys examine or look at the prescription medications, or was that not necessary in this particular instance?
I believe they were looked at, yes.
Item number 44, what are we looking at in this picture?
This photo was taken in the kitchen at the bottom of the stairs to the second floor.
And when you walk into the kitchen from the dining room, where would this staircase be located?
The staircase is located at the south end of the kitchen.
Slide 45, is that a picture of the staircase going upstairs?
Yes, it is.
And slide number 46, is that a picture of the top of the staircase?
Yes, it is.
When you get to the top of the staircase, what direction would you go to access any rooms upstairs?
You have to turn west.
Item number 47, could you tell us what's in this picture?
This is a photo of the trash can that was in the kitchen.
And item number 48, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is another photo of the kitchen. The stairway to the upstairs is to the right in this photo.
Okay, and where is the dining room in relation to this photo? Is there another doorway to the far right of the picture?
Yes, there is.
Okay, and where does that doorway lead to?
That goes to, we called it the pantry. It was an area that had several shelves full of food. And then it also led to the back door and down to the basement stairs.
Slide number 48, what are we looking at in this picture?
That is the doorway to the back end of the house.
Excuse me, that's slide number 49. Picture number 50, what are we looking at in this picture?
This, it appears to be a shoe rack that is in the back of the house, and the pantry area is to the left, and the back door, basement stairways, are to the right.
Slide number 51, what are we looking at in this picture?
In this picture, you can see the back door and the entryway to the basement stairs.
And slide number 52, where are we looking at in that picture?
The entryway to the basement stairs.
Now, slide number 53, what room are we in this slide?
This is the bathroom that is off the kitchen.
And we see another animal in that picture?
Yes.
Slide number 54, what is in this slide?
This is the basement stairway.
As you're going down the basement stairs, was there anything unusual to you as you went down the stairs?
The bottom stair wasn't painted. It looked a little different than the other stairs.
Were there any missing stairs in there?
You don't believe there were, no.
So the bottom stair wasn't painted. The wall to the left in this picture as you go down the basement stairs, do you remember anything specifically about that particular wall?
I don't recall.
Did it appear to be freshly painted to you?
I don't recall.
Moving on to slide number 55, what do we see in this picture, and what room are we looking into?
This photo was taken at the bottom of the stairs. You have to turn right to get into the basement.
And what is the red material in this picture?
It appeared to be some sort of curtain.
Slide number 56, where is this in relation as you enter the basement?
This appears to be up to the left.
Slide number 57, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is a photo of the basement taken from the basement entryway.
And in the foreground of the photo, do you see a shop vac?
Yes.
And farther past that in the photograph, do we see a washing machine and a dryer?
Yes.
Slide number 58, what do we see in this picture?
This is another photo of the basement. You can see the shop vac.
And beyond that, do you see some cleaning items or something on the floor?
Let me get a closer look.
There might be a closer picture. Slide number 59, what do we see in this picture?
Appears to be a photo of a workbench that was in the basement.
Slide number 60, what do we see in that picture?
It's another photo of the workbench.
Underneath the workbench, what do you see?
There appears to be several buckets and totes.
And do you recall what was in those items?
I don't recall those items.
Your Honor, if I may approach with a closer view.
You may.
It appears to be dirt or soil.
In all of those items?
Yes.
Okay, this is slide number 61, but the lighting is a little bit bad in this picture. What do you see?
It appears to be another portion of the basement. There what looks like a red bucket and then some possible problems on the floor.
Slide number 62, where are we at in the basement in this picture?
Can I get a closer view?
Yes.
Thank you.
At some point in time, while you guys were in the basement, were the curtains taken down by the entryway?
For lighting purposes? I don't believe they were taken down. They may have been moved, but I don't believe they were taken down. So this is another image of the entryway to the basement. You can see the opening for to the stairway. In the center of the photo, with the red curtains.
Thank you. Slide number 63. What are we looking at in this picture?
This is another view of the basement.
And in this view, is there a doorway to the right-hand side of the picture?
Yes, there is.
And where did that doorway lead?
That led into another small room in the basement.
Slide number 64, is this a closer view of those materials that were on the floor that may or may not have been cleaning products?
Yes.
Slide number 65, what are we looking at here?
This photo was taken toward the back of the basement. You can see the entryway to the stairway.
In this photograph, it does not appear as if the curtains go all the way to the floor.
That's
the entryway, is that accurate?
That's correct.
Slide number 66, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is another photo of that doorway to the small room in the basement.
And slide number 67, what is that?
These are the contents that were in the small room in the basement.
Slide number 68, what are we looking at in this picture? Do you need a closer view?
I do.
The lighting is a little bad.
It appears to be, you can see the railing to the stairway that goes up the stairs to the main floor.
Is there some sort of ledge on the left side of the room?
Yes, there is.
And slide number 69?
This is another photo of the stairway. The ledge is over to the left.
These are the basement stairs?
Yes.
We're now to slide number 70. What room are we looking at in this picture?
This is the living room.
And 71, is that another view of the living room?
Yes, it is.
Could you tell us what direction we would be facing looking in this picture?
We'd be facing south.
Slide number 72. What do we see in this slide?
This is another photo of the living room. There is a TV. It appears to be possibly a blanket. And the TV is on some sort of entertainment stand.
The slide number 73, is that a closer view of the entertainment stand?
Yes.
Slide number 74, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is on the second floor, and this photo was taken in the room that appears to be the study of the office.
Is this the room, farthest room from the stairway going upstairs?
Yes, it is.
Does it appear that there's been any recent remodeling in this room?
I don't recall.
Okay. Slide number 75. Is this another view of the office?
Yes, it is.
And slide number 76, what do we see in that picture?
This photo was taken inside the office, and that is the doorway that goes to the hallway on the second floor.
And is this a view in slide number 77 of the items in the office?
Yes, it is.
And another view of the items in the office?
Yes, it is.
Slide number 79, what do we see in this photograph?
It appears there is a cell phone plugged into the wall.
And what color is it?
White.
And can you make out the brand of the cell phone?
It appears to be Apple.
Slide number 80, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is a photo from the hallway upstairs looking into the master bedroom.
And slide number 81?
This is another photo of the bedroom.
Is there some sort of, is there something on the chair in this photograph?
It appears there is a blanket or a comforter.
Is that red?
Yes, it is.
Slide number 82. Is this the other side of the bed in the bedroom upstairs?
Yes, it is.
And slide number 83. What is the doorway in slide number 83 that we see?
That goes to the closet.
On slide number 84, what do we see in that picture?
That is a view of the closet from the bedroom.
Slide number 85.
That's an additional view of the closet.
And slide number 86.
That's a photo of some contents in the closet.
Slide number 87, what do we see in this picture and where is it in relation to the closet?
In this case, the closet is at the bottom of the photograph. It appears to be several, weapon-type items.
When you say, go back for a moment to that slide. Slide number 87, when you say weapons, are these, sword-type weapons? Medieval-type weapons?
Medieval-type weapons, yes.
Slide number 88, what room are we in now?
We're in the dining room at this point.
And was there anything of interest in the carpeting in this area?
Not this particular area, no.
Slide number 89. What are we looking at in this picture and where is it located?
This is a photo of the door trim that is located between the dining room and the foyer.
And why take a close-up photograph of the door trim here?
There was some reddish-brown staining on the door trim.
And slide number 90, what are we looking at in this picture?
On the bottom of the photograph, you can see a doorway that goes from the dining room to the foyer. This photo is a picture of the ceiling in the dining room.
And was there something about the ceiling in the dining room that was of particular interest?
There appeared to be a spotted pattern on the ceiling. It was slightly discolored.
And slide number 91, is that a closer view of the ceiling?
Yes, it is.
And can you see in this particular picture, you may be too far away, but can you see in slide number 91 where the pattern is?
I cannot see it from here.
Your Honor, may I publish slide number 91 to the jury?
Why don't you show it to the witness first?
Yes.
And is it just a faint discoloration on the ceiling tiles?
Yes, it is.
May I publish it? And slide number 92, is that a different angle?
Yes.
Of the same ceiling tiles?
Yes.
May I also publish that to the jury room?
Yes.
Slide number 93, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is the door between the dining room and the foyer, and the duct tape was taken off.
Is the duct tape was taken off, or was the cork board taken off?
This is the side where the duct tape was taken off.
Okay. This is slide number 93. Slide number 94, and what are we looking at in this picture? I'm sorry. My apologies.
This is the cork board that was on the door.
Is this the back side of the cork board?
I believe so, yes.
Slide number 95, where we get in this picture.
This is the dining room ceiling again.
And slide number 96, you may not be, well, maybe you can see it from here. What are we looking at in this picture of the dining room ceiling?
This is the dining room ceiling after Blue and All was applied to it.
And do you see a faint, darker discoloration in this picture?
Yes.
Can I publish that to the jury?
Yes.
Slide number 97, what are we looking at in this picture?
This is the trim on one of the walls in the dining room, and there was some reddish brown discoloration there.
And slide number 98, what do we see in that picture?
That is the bookcase against one of the walls in the dining room, and there is some discoloration around the bottom of that.
Slide number 99, what are we looking at in this picture, and are we in the dining room?
This was taken in the dining room. The wall, or the door to the foyer is to the right. It appears to be that the carpet has been pulled up.
Was there anything of interest or any reason the carpet was pulled up?
The crime scene team sprayed luminol on the carpet, and there was an area of interest located. So it was pulled up to do further testing and to take back to the laboratory.
Slide 100, is that the back side of the carpeting that we're looking at, that picture?
Yes, it is.
And was there, it may be difficult for you to see, is there some pen or some markings in that picture?
Yes, there are.
And was that something that you would have done or some other member of the crime scene team?
No, that's something I would have done, yes.
Slide number 101, what are we looking at in this picture?
That is item L19. That was taken. It appears to be one of the hinges from the door, from the dining room to the foyer.
Slide number 102. What is this picture of?
It appears to be the inside of the garage.
And did you also process the garage on this particular trip to the Cochran residence?
No.
Slide number 103. What are we seeing in this picture?
This is another image of the garage.
And is this the main service door to the garage?
No, this is the side door.
And slide number 104, what do we see in this picture?
That's another image of the garage, the big garage door. You can see it's in the back of the photo.
Slide number 105. What do we see in this picture?
This is another image of the garage.
In what direction would we be looking at in this picture?
Can I see a close-up photo?
Yes.
Thank you.
Maybe you can.
Are we nearing the end?
We are, Your Honor, yes.
I believe it is to the east, but I am not 100% certain.
Okay, thank you. Slide number 106, what do we see in this picture?
This is another image of the garage.
Slide 107, is this also an image of the garage?
Yes, it is.
A closer picture of the other items in the garage?
Yes.
Slide number 108, which is the last slide. What are we looking at in this picture?
This is the entry door to the garage.
When you guys went to the home and processed it, we did look at a bunch of pictures in here, and there was processing of the scene by other agencies, correct, after Michigan State Police processed the scene?
Yes.
To your knowledge. So what did you do first with respect to processing the scene after the photographs?
I'm going to take our morning recess. Folks, we'll come back in this session in about 15 minutes.
All rise. Court is in recess.